Afternoon. In the last class, we had seen how ISP and non-dimensional thrust depend on efficiency as well as theta b and theta naught. Okay. In this class, we'll go further and find out what happens. Can we get a ramjet which can start below Mach number 1? Is that possible? Or a subsonic? In other words, subsonic ramjets, are they possible? And then we'll also look at whether ramjets are self-starting. We know for sure ramjets are not self-starting. Whether our equations will bring it out is what we are going to see. Fine. And we'll also look at what happens to thrust per unit mass flow rate and other things, okay, as we go along in this class. Now, if you remember, we had derived expression and said that 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m4 square must be equal to eta into okay. This was the expression that we had derived in the last class. Now, if you put eta is equal to 1, that is ideal case. If we look at an ideal case, okay, what happens here? We get this relationship that m4 must be equal to m0. So, does it mean that at the exit Mach number is the same as the inlet Mach number, then it won't produce any thrust? Is that the case? What do you think will happen? We are looking at an ideal case, and this case exit and inlet Mach numbers are the same. So, do you think it will produce thrust or not produce thrust? Yeah, you are right. If you look at Mach number, Mach numbers might be the same. What we are interested in is exit velocity and inlet velocity, okay. So, Mach numbers being the same does not mean anything, because if you know that at the exit of the nozzle, temperatures can be 500 to 1000 Kelvin greater than inlet. So, if you have the flow through the nozzle wherein the temperatures are higher, then the speed of sound at that location will be higher, and therefore you will be able to still produce thrust if efficiencies are 1. Now, we have derived expression for non-dimensional thrust as this was our non-dimensional thrust equation. Now, in this, if we put eta is equal to 1, this simplifies to So, for efficiencies being all 1 unity ideal system, you get this expression for non-dimensional thrust, and similarly one can get an expression for ISP. Now, if you look at this expression for non-dimensional thrust, what you see here is If theta b increases, what happens to the non-dimensional thrust? Theta b, remember, is under the designer's control. That is, you can choose what is the exit temperature at the exit of the combustor by burning suitable amounts of fuel. There is an upper limit. That is, if you are using kerosene air, there is an upper limit of 2300 Kelvin, which is the stoichiometric combustion temperature. But other than that, you can vary the air fuel ratio and get different temperatures. This number is under your control, right? And one, it is very obvious that if you increase theta b, you get a larger f by m dot a naught. Now, what this value f by m dot a naught indicates is that you will see, as this number is higher, the size of the ramjet becomes smaller. So, larger value of means smaller size of which is desirable, because your drag will then be smaller. Okay, so you need a larger value of this, and if theta b increases, you will find that as a consequence f by m dot a naught also increases. Okay, now when we were discussing ramjets earlier in the introductory classes, I had made a point that ramjets are not self starting. That is, they need something to take them to a slightly higher Mach number, and then they will start from there on. Let us see if we can bring that out from this equation. If we put m naught equal to 0 here, what happens? M naught is the Mach number at the inlet. If we put that to 0, that is, if you are holding the vehicle stationary, what happens to the thrust? This goes to 0. So, not self starting, or in other words, static thrust is 0. So, if you put the ramjet on a thrust stand and you do not give the flow, that is, you do not induce the flow yourself, then it would not be able to produce any thrust even if you switch on the fuel flow rate. Okay. We know now that it does not produce any static thrust. Is there any value of Mach number at which it will start producing some thrust? That is our next exercise. We know that static thrust is 0 here. Let us now find out what happens at what Mach number can we get some meaningful thrust. Okay. Now, we know that efficiencies, if you remember, efficiencies will always be less than 1, and when we multiply all of them, the product range between product that is eta range between 0.84 and 0.97, right. So, efficiencies will always be less than 1. So, if you incorporate it and try and see what happens at what Mach number will we get some thrust. Okay. To derive that, we need to look at this expression here. Okay. This is the expression, and we know that if it has to produce positive thrust, this number should be greater than 0, right. So if it has to be greater than 0, then obviously the product of the first two numbers must be greater than 1, or if you look at the terms in the bracket, this should be greater than 1. So we will put that down. I will also include the 1 plus f term here. The remember we had neglected this term for our convenience, so for positive thrust 1 plus f should be greater than 1. Okay. Now we can square both sides and cross multiply, and we will get this condition that should be greater than theta b. Okay. Even though f is smaller here, this quantity can be slightly larger, therefore I have taken that into account in this equation. Okay. Now this is a slightly cumbersome equation to solve and bring out what should be the value of Mach number at which it will give positive thrust. So the easier way is you plot a graph and then try and find out where it leads you. Okay, and that is what is done in this plot here. What is plotted is non-dimensional thrust variation with flight Mach number. That is, as you increase m naught, what happens to f by m dot a naught. You notice that there are 4 lines here, each corresponding to a different value of efficiency. This is for eta is equal to 1, so you have it starting from 0 itself. Okay. Whereas all the other lines are clubbed somewhere close to 1, where efficiencies are around 0.86. Okay. So if you have a non-unity efficiency, that is for real systems, you notice that it is very difficult to have a subsonic ramjet. Okay, whatever be the theta b that you can go up to, right? Theta b is the ratio of combustion exit temperature, combustor exit temperature to the inlet temperature. Even if you add more heat, even if you keep on adding more heat, it does not matter, we have varied theta b from 6 to 10 almost by a factor of 2. Even if you add more heat, it does not matter, you still cannot have something like a subsonic ramjet, okay. This is purely determined by efficiencies. For non-unity efficiencies, you cannot have subsonic ramjets. And what you will notice here is that all these systems have their thrust to, or the non-dimensional thrust is maximum at somewhere between 2 to 3, okay. So it is a maxima for F by a Mach number range of 2 to 3, right. But we need to take this result a little more carefully. What we have looked at in this analysis is, this is only the thrust produced by the ramjet. We have not accounted for the net thrust, that is thrust minus the drag, right. There is a drag component also that determines whether the vehicle will move forward or not, and that will make it go even further, right. If you look at this graph, in this graph at this Mach number, F by m dot a naught is this much, there will be drag, right. So that drag will bring down this value, and probably you will start producing net thrust somewhere at a slightly higher Mach number, right. So typically you will not find any subsonic ramjets, that is the underlying message from this graph, okay. So when we consider net thrust, that is thrust minus the drag portion, then the starting Mach number will be higher, and we cannot have subsonic ramjets for efficiencies less than 1, okay. Now in this graph we see that F by m dot a naught varies in this fashion, and if I were to look at ISP variation, remember ISP by a naught is nothing but m naught into ISP what would be a preferable thing, having a larger value of ISP or a smaller value of ISP? If you remember SFC, we need a smaller value, and ISP being 1 over SFC, we need a larger value of ISP. If you notice here, you have theta b appearing here as well as here, right, in two places in this expression, and here it is under root sign and here it is not under root sign. Okay. So what do you expect to happen? If theta b increases, what happens to ISP? ISP should decrease. Okay. And what should happen with efficiencies? If efficiencies are less than 1, what should happen to ISPs? It should also again decrease. And the same thing is plotted here in this graph. What you see here is ISP on the y axis versus Mach number, the flight Mach number, for an efficiency of 0.86 with different theta b's. As theta b is increased from 6 to 10, you see that the ISPs are lower. Okay. So which means SFCs will be higher or fuel consumption will be more, which is not a desirable feature. So you would like to operate such that theta b is lower, so that your fuel consumption is less. But then if you go back to the previous curve, you will find that if theta b is less, your F by m dot a naught will also decrease, or the thrust will also decrease. So you should design such that this is a large quantity, so that your size becomes smaller. Okay. And then the other thing will automatically get fixed. Okay. Now we looked at how the non-dimensional thrust varies with theta b. Let us look at what happens with m naught. We have already seen that in graph. Let us try and bring out if we can do some analysis and find out what happens with Mach number. Mach number, if you notice here, it appears this is the expression that we are looking for. It express it, you find Mach number in m naught and theta naught, it appears in both places. So it is not obvious as theta b is. We noted that with the increase in theta b, it is this becomes smaller, which is what we found in the curves. But Mach number is not such a straightforward relationship. Let us try and find out what happens there. That is what we are trying to find out, is there an optimal Mach number at which, if we fly, it seems that it should lie somewhere between 2 and 3. Can we bring that out through some analysis here? So what do? We take a derivative with respect to m naught. So firstly, we will assume eta to be 1, so that we do not end up with a large or a cumbersome equation. So if you look at eta is equal to 1, the expression for F by m dot a naught would be m naught into under root theta b by theta naught minus 1. So now if we take a derivative of this, with respect to M naught. Let me also include 1 plus f. Now, if we take a derivative, we will get 1 into the rest of the things, 1 plus f under root theta b by theta naught minus 1 minus half m naught into 1 plus f theta b. Theta b does not vary with m naught. So, theta b does not get changed here. So, theta naught to the power of 3 by 2 into gamma minus 1 m naught. Okay. And for a maxima, this must be equal to 0. So, if we equate this to 0, then both these two must be equal. We will get one plus f, this must be equal to 0 under root theta b by theta naught minus half into gamma minus 1 m naught square. Okay. What is this quantity here? What is the definition of theta naught? Theta naught is so what you have here is theta naught minus 1. So if you put that, you will get 1 plus f theta b minus theta naught into, and do the simplification, that you will get this theta naught minus 1 divided by, this must be equal to 1, or theta b by theta naught into this becomes theta naught minus theta naught plus 1. So, theta naught cancels out, you get 1 by theta naught. Is equal to 1. Theta naught to the power of 3 by 2 must be equal to this is the expression that we get for maximum value of f by m dot a naught occurs when theta naught is in this. This is the value of theta naught that we have. Now we plug in some typical values. We will find out what we had discovered earlier, that it ranges somewhere between 2.5 to 3. So if we take TT3 to be 2300 Kelvin, which is what you will get as the adiabatic flame temperature if you use kerosene air system at stoichiometric condition, and I will take T0 to be 230 Kelvin, that is as you go higher in altitude temperature drops. So at some particular altitude you will get this temperature, and therefore my theta b will be 10, and if I use seven, okay, you will find that theta naught we will get as somewhere between 2.25 to 2.15. This depends on what value of f you consider, and correspondingly this will also change a little, okay, and therefore m naught to be somewhere between 2.4 to 2.5. okay, so you will notice that most systems, most real systems, although all this analysis we have carried out with eta to be 1, even if you put in the efficiencies, we had seen in the graphs that Mach number range for high value of f by m dot a naught ranges between 2 to 3, which is where you will find most operating systems, okay. Most systems would want to go to that condition and then fly in that Mach number range, okay, so that you have a larger value of f by m dot a naught. Okay, this finishes our discussions on ramjets. Now let us move on to the next engine, that is the turbojet, okay. Turbojet has a slightly involved system. It has a compressor and a turbine, so we need to account for that here, okay. Now when we look at turbojets, there are two things that we can look at. One is when the nozzle is choked, and the other is when the nozzle, or when the flow through the nozzle is optimally expanded. Firstly, we will consider the case wherein it is the flow through the nozzle is optimally expanded, and we will try to find out what equations we will get. A turbojet similar to a ramjet will have an intake, and then we'll have a compressor. Which is connected to a turbine, and you have a combustion chamber in between. And then you have a jet pipe or an afterburner, and then a convergent nozzle. Okay. So let me again call these stations as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6 and 7. This is the 0 to 2 is the intake, 2 to 3 is compressor, 3 to 4 is combustor, 4 is the turbine. And this is the afterburner, and then the convergent nozzle. As I had said earlier, we don't use typically a CT nozzle. The only aircraft or a rail system that has a turbojet which uses a convergent divergent nozzle is the, what is the engine, Olympus engine, right, on what is that, Concorde aircraft. Okay. So other than that, typically only a convergent nozzle is used, because the pressure at the exit of the turbine is very low, and it would not be useful if you have a convergent divergent nozzle, and therefore only a convergent nozzle is used. Now here we will take up the case where P7 is equal to P0. Okay. That is, optimally expanded flow. Notice here that you have compressor extra and the turbine extra. So we need to define certain other parameters. That is, we will define compressor pressure ratio I will call it pi c. Pi c is nothing but PT3 by PT2, and T again here indicates stagnation conditions. From this we can define tau c, that is nothing but PT3 by PT2, which is pi c to the power of gamma minus 1 by gamma. Okay. And similarly I can define a turbine pressure ratio So from this I can define tau t, which is nothing but tt5 by tt4 okay. So now with this, and we know that from our previous calculation theta naught is nothing but tt naught by t naught, that is 1 plus gamma minus 1 m naught square, fine. And based on this I can get m naught is equal to under root 2 by gamma minus 1 theta naught minus 1. The other parameter that we need to define is theta b, okay. In this case I will define theta b as tt4 by t naught, okay. So theta b is nothing but tt4 by t naught, which I can rewrite as tt4 by tt3 into tt3 by tt2 into tt2 by tt0 tt0 by t0. What is tt4 by tt3? This I will call it as tau b, similar to what we had done earlier. I will call this as tau b, and tt3 by tt2, again we have it here, it is pi c and or tau c, sorry. And what is tt naught, tt2 by tt naught? If we assume isentropic processes, this will be 1, this is flow through, this is flow through intake, and just like in the previous case, if the process is isentropic we can get this to be 1, and lastly this is nothing but theta naught, okay. So I get my expression for theta b or tau b, I can write it as now we want to derive expressions for thrust. So the thrust equation is F is equal to m dot a into, in this case the exit velocity is at V7, okay, and intake is at 0. So you get V7 into we had assumed P7 is equal to P0, and therefore this goes to 0 and we will also make the other assumption that F is very much less than 1. This is more true in a ram, in a turbojet compared to a ramjet, because in the main combustor it will be much lower than 0.067, because you are worried about the turbine inlet temperature, so you want it to be much lower than the stoichiometric condition. So F is less than 1, so I can neglect this part and I get f is equal to m dot a v 7 minus v naught, and we will do the similar procedure as we did last time. So I can write this as m dot a naught m naught into m 7 by m naught into under root t 7 by t naught minus 1. Again we have used the relationship for speed of sound here, okay, and we have again made the assumption that gamma and r are the same for exhaust gases as well as incoming air. So assuming gamma and r to be same for gases and air, okay. So we get this relationship. Now again we need to look at these two ratios, okay, or we can write the non-dimensional thrust as we can write the expression for non-dimensional thrust as m naught into m 7 by m naught So we are again left with the task of trying to find these two ratios. Again we will follow a similar procedure of cascading temperatures and cascading pressures, right. Now what I want you to think about is, all the while I have been telling you that you are looking at flow through intake, and I said we are looking at isentropic conditions. In the previous case that we took up ramjet, we looked at all the temperature ratios and efficiencies never figured in that place, right. Why does efficiency only figure when we are looking at pressures, and why does not it figure here? Now in the previous case also we had looked at a realistic system, right. So we cannot look at a realistic system and say the flow through the intake is isentropic. So what really is the crux there? Why are we taking this as one, and why do we take the other thing wherein when we look at pressures we are looking at efficiencies here, okay. We will discuss this in the next class, okay. Thank you very much.